Another threat was the grenade, an old weapon revived for trench fighting.
Well, the early ones, you had what they call a fusee. They had a little wick on them, and you lit the end of the fuse like a cracker. Then the next bomb came out, it had on the end of that wick, they had a little Vestas top, a match top. And they gave us a matchbox side pinned on there or tied on. And you just stuck the bomb head or the Vestas there on it, and it would start to fuse, see? And off she went. But no one held it much more than that. It didn't go 4.5 seconds before you got rid of it.
Both sides used an ever-increasing quantity of hand grenades. The German grenade had a stick attached and earned its nickname from its similarity to an old-fashioned potato masher. Some grenades could be fired from rifles. Yet more deadly than grenade or machine gun was the towering rage of the artillery. The sheer weight of fire which bore down upon the infantryman finally drove him underground.
Now, this trench in Sanctuary Wood at Ypres has been patched up rather than preserved, but we can still see some of the features that gave trench warfare its own distinctive and ghastly character. The trench was a zigzag, and this was partly so that one single shell burst could not devastate a whole line of trench, and partly so that each bay could be defended if the enemy infiltrated himself into any part of the system. But struggling round these bays, carrying a wounded man on a stretcher, was a painful and exhausting business. Men lived in dugouts, entered by steps leading from the trench. Sometimes these were relatively comfortable, but their occupants had to live with the risk of being buried alive, either if the entrance was blown in, or if the whole structure collapsed under a heavy shell. Wooden duckboards covered the bottom of the trench, while pumps tried to keep them from flooding. All too often, though, the trench was deep in mud, water, and filth, and infested with ravening rats.
Everybody were lousy, and every time you went to the loo, you'd run your thumb up the seams of your trousers and crack them there, they were going off like a machine gun firing. And everybody were the same. We had the clothes for over 12 months before we had a change. We had a change at Popper Inge. Easy 12 months after we'd left England.
This trench would have been deep enough for men to have walked along the middle like this without being seen. And on the enemy side ran the fire step, a narrow ridge on which men could stand to fire over the parapet.
There's a ledge behind your back. That's to guard your back, you see, in case shell falls behind. But actually, it was your table. It was your dining table. And a little cavity there, you see, you used to build, make a fire in, and put a slight grid in front and cook on top of it. And you were actually supplied with coal and wood to make a fire to cook your food.
These rusty fragments are remnants of the mass of trench stores, rolls of barbed wire, wire pickets, corrugated iron, sandbags, and so on, which were an essential part of trench warfare. They helped to make life barely tolerable, but they all had to be carried up from far in the rear by infantrymen, often exhausted, through hundreds of yards of communication trench. Big battles apart, the infantryman lived in his strangely old-fashioned troglodyte world. It had much in common with siege operations in previous wars. That hardy annual body armor reappeared. Steel helmets, some of them with a curiously medieval appearance, were here to stay.
The bright spots in the trenches used to be when it happened to be a lovely fine day and you'd suddenly see a lark spin up into the sky and sing its heart out and you'd think, my God, don't I wish I was you, you know? And then, of course, too, there were long periods of boredom.
World War I was the epitome of the infantryman's war, forcing him to seek safety in trenches. Since then, the foot soldier has acquired protection of a different sort in the armored personnel carrier, developed during the Second World War.
Guts, guts, guts!
The APC enables him to keep pace with armor and protects him against bullets and shell splinters. It also helps keep out gas and even nuclear fallout. There comes a moment when the door opens and the infantryman is on his feet with his rifle in the same unforgiving world that his fathers knew. He has some new weapons to help him meet new threats, just as the longbow harassed the medieval knight. So infantry anti-tank weapons threaten enemy armored vehicles on the battlefield of the 80s. Tanks are a formidable enemy to the foot soldier, but infantry are dangerous vermin too, hard to brush out of the seams of the soil. Indeed, if tanks are to survive in close country or towns, they need their own infantry to protect them. Flamethrowers first appeared in World War I, but they have been a conspicuous feature in all the succeeding wars. The Americans in particular used fire to burn out the stubborn Japanese defenders of the Pacific Islands. And the infantryman has his own artillery, the mortar. It's light enough to be dismantled and carried by its crew, and fires high angle, over obstacles and from behind cover. Its projectile, arriving with a sinister, feathery shuffle, was loathed by soldiers in all armies. And the infantry rifle itself can lay down a weight of fire that the musketeer would never have dreamed of. But whatever weapon the infantryman carries, his war retains its own hard edge. Nothing can free him from his obligation to close and kill. In war, possession is 9 points of the law, and the infantrymen are the bailiff's men.